Ah, it's Frank and Claire. They're saying goodbye at the train station, like every good couple did in World War II. But it's Claire going off to war, and Frank is left behind. She's ahead of her time, even in her time.
Never can.
Of course, it's just a memory.
Splish splash, I was taking a bath.
That Mrs. Fitz sure knows how to shake a person up. In fact, she's got Claire breaking down and confessing to being from the future. Surely Mrs. Fitz will understand. But no, she accuses Claire of being a demon, a witch. But no, again. Claire is still stuck in 1743 on her own, and that was all in her head. At least now she has something to do. She keeps busy cleaning up the surgery, exploring Davy Beaton's collection, and tending the castle folk. Although they've set up headquarters at the kitchen supply of alcohol, Angus and Rupert are still guarding her. Claire meets Mrs. Fitz's nephew, Thomas, and finds out about his friend who died mysteriously. I bet we hear more about this later. Meanwhile, Claire is summoned to Cullum's study, just in time to find out why he's so strict with his tailor. Wow, is he strict! Cullum has called for Claire to rub his shrunken little Toulouse-Lautrec legs. She's such a good nurse, she shows him there's a better place to massage.
Come here, baby. Scratching my back.
Cullum is pleased and invites Claire to attend an evening of wine and song. Claire hangs out with Larry. She's in such a good mood, she decides to try and play the match game with Jamie and Larry. But, Jamie's just not into it at all.
Go away, go.
In fact, he uses his shoulder as an excuse to get Claire away. Come on, this is the same guy who fell off a horse rather than admit he was shot. Claire, you're not buying this, are you? Yeah, she sure is.
And when he walked me home.
Once again, Jamie manages to share things that entrance Claire just a little bit more. And then Jamie leaves. No, really. The next day, Claire exasperates Angus by trekking out to the garden to meet Galus. Remember how I told you that Mrs. Fitz's nephew was going to pop up again? Well, Claire finds out from Galus that now Thomas is sick, just like his friend that died. As Galus describes it, he has been seized with evil, and there will be an exorcism done by Father Bane. Despite Galus's warning to stay out of it, and dire warnings from Angus, Claire takes off to see what she can do at the Baxter Cottage.
I'm walking, hear the need, I'm talking. Find you and me, I'm hoping that you come back to me.
She examines Thomas and wants to try and help him. Then the charming Father Bane comes in, and Claire offers a little advice. Needless to say, the father is not pleased, and Mrs. Fitz and her sister are too afraid to go against him, so Claire leaves. Back at the castle, Claire is trying to figure out how to get Mrs. Fitz on her side when she sees Jamie kissing Larry.
Put his arms around your waist, held you tight, kisses I could almost taste in the night.
Despite starting the whole matchmaker thing, I don't think Claire is pleased. Later at dinner, she decides to tease Jamie about it. Jamie and Larry sitting in a tree. K-I-S-S-I-N-G. Jamie decides discretion is the better part of valor and leaves. However, Murtaugh stays and gives Claire a good talking to. Claire feels genuinely ashamed, and she's sorry for herself, because she's really missing Frank. Poor Claire. But she's pleased when she's allowed to visit Galus the next day. Although Claire enjoys her time away from the castle, Galus is pumping her for details, but in a much more subtle way than Colum and Dougal.
Tell me something good.
Suddenly, there's a big commotion out in the square, and Claire finds out that a boy accused of stealing bread will be punished by losing a hand. Yikes! When Galus's husband comes in, Claire pleads for leniency for the boy, but he's all gassy, or somewhere in that zone, and doesn't want to listen. Luckily, Galus takes pity and finds a solution. Now that he's in a better mood, he decides that the boy only has to have 1 hour in the pillory and 1 ear pegged. Lucky boy.
Better knock on wood, baby.
Jamie comes to escort Claire back to the castle. As they leave, Claire finds out that the boy will have to rip his own ear to get away. Ew. She asks Jamie to help free the boy, and of course, he agrees.
The things we do for love, the things we do for love.
As long as he's so willing, Claire asks Jamie to take her to the Black Kirk, the supposed source of Thomas's sickness. Jamie gives her details about the place, and though he says he's an educated man, he still respects the legends. As Jamie describes kids eating berries and wood garlic, Claire realizes, that's not wood garlic, that's Lily of the Valley.
Hi, Lily, hi, Lily, hi-lo.
By George, I think she's got it. Move over, Father Bane. This time, Mrs. Fitz supports her, and Claire administers the antidote. Thomas is saved.
I believe in miracles since you came along.
Father Bane is not amused. But Claire is quite pleased with herself, until Jamie makes her realize that now that she's proven her value with her skills, Colum won't want to let her go.
Oh Lord, stuck in a low die again.
Claire feels self-conscious going out in public after that whole miracle thing, but the lure of Colum's Rhenish trumps all. With drink in hand and Jamie translating by her side, Claire settles in despite all the stares. And she hears a tale of a woman who travels through standing stone.
Here's a story of a lovely lady.
Her heart leaps when it's told that the lady traveled back through the stones to her own time. If it happened to her, why not Claire? Maybe there's a chance for her yet. Join me for my next episode recap. Same cat time, same cat channel. Cats and Kelts and